Hi, and welcome to video 5 of Offshore Wind Explained from DNV Digital Solutions. I am Ole Jan Nekstad, Business Development Director for the world-known tools Sesam and Bladed that have been explained to you in earlier sessions. Today, I will talk about the question that many in the industry is asking, and that is, how will the size of a turbine impact the selection of a floating substructure? I think there are none in the industry that has a clear opinion or answer to that, simply because there are no reference documents or enough simulations of floating wind offshore turbines. But what we know for a fact is that the size of turbines had grown dramatically over the last years, and that floater opened for even larger turbines than for fixed offshore installations. So for example, 17 years ago in 2007, Equinor installed a Hywind demo with a 2.3 megawatt turbine with a turbine rotor of 82 meters. Then later on came Hywind Scotland in 2017 with a 6 megawatt turbine capacity, and that had a rotor diameter of 155 meters, which is a dramatic increase. To my knowledge, today the largest installed turbine or being on an installed floating offshore unit is 9.5 megawatt with a rotor diameter of 236 meters. This is on the Kincardine project in UK. The next ones that can be ordered today has a capacity of 15 megawatt with also a diameter of 236 meters. But there are even larger in the pipeline. So there exist turbine concepts for offshore use producing 22 megawatt with a diameter of 310 meters. So if you think about it, this is actually a quadruple increase of the diameter since 2007. And that is quite dramatic. And obviously, a more powerful turbine has a heavier nacelle, larger blades and higher tower, impacting the size and possibly the type of the floater that you might select to support it. A floating offshore wind installation is an interconnected system of components. In other words, it is engineering of a system where one creates models of each component and maps the independencies and sensitivities of each component to each other or to the others. By this, one can understand that the impact of decisions in one area can be captured in another, and that the impact of KPIs for the whole system, such as levelized cost of electricity or, for example, internal rate of return, can be understood. For this, DNV has developed a tool called Renewables Architect that could help you to find these KPIs. Larger turbines and larger substructures will result in more wind and wave forces, and these will have to be accounted for when you design the floating substructure. This is a highly complex task and will require simulations and advanced software tools to do calculate the numbers and validating the results from model wave tanks. When the forces have been established, structural analysis must be performed to document that the tower and the substructure can resist the forces, and also very important, avoid the natural frequencies from the rotating turbines and the motions of the structure. This is an iterative process where the reinforcement or layout is modified during design iterations. And the more you are away from, you know, previous designs or what might you have in your competence book, the more challenging it is. In most cases, both the substructure designer and the wind turbine manufacturer do their own detailed simulations and analysis of both the substructure and the wind turbine, and of course the tower. This means that they will need to wait for updated design revisions from each other before they can continue with their own next design iteration. The goal is obviously to document that the substructure and the mooring and the cable system can properly support the turbine, its blades and the tower, And not to forget, will it be possible to build, transport and install offshore, knowing the limits of construction sites, vessels and cranes for transportation and installation? Lots of considerations must also be done on how to do O&M or operation and maintenance. Accidents can and will happen, so one must have a contingency plan on how to do repair of, for example, a turbine or even replace the nacelle. This will pose challenges to where such repairs can be done, as there are limits with, say, for example, crane capacities, weather windows, and so forth. When we talk about floating offshore wind substructures, there are predominantly four types we can mention here. That is the semi-sub, the spar, the tension leg platform, and the barges. From another perspective, we could also use the triangle behind me to identify the main stabilization strategies of different concepts. When selecting a substructure type, what really matters is how to make sure that the LCOE stays as low as possible. In other words, one has to make sure that the cost of design, construction, installation, and maintenance of larger substructures won't up the gains from producing more electricity by using larger turbines. Thus, one needs to focus optimization of the whole system and not sub-optimization of individual components. One should be careful of putting floater types against each other, but maybe some food for thought. Based on the experience from current on-duty floating offshore wind projects, my view is that the semi-concept is the most balanced one in terms of adaptability and reliability to support different size of wind turbines and their applications in different water depths. So semi-subs might therefore be what you can call a consider safe choice for pilot and pre-commercial projects, where often the reliability is on the top of the consideration list. But the floater seems to be the heaviest one compared to the other one, to the others, considering its multi-column configuration. And because of the complex design of the hull, the fatigue risk may be higher than the others, especially on the brace hull connection areas. I think that the spar concept is a very elegant design in terms of simplicity of its hull form. It's really just a column. This could bring potential quicker structure design and sizing, lower fatigue risk, and easier manufacturing with respect to time and cost. It has the lowest center of gravity, which is an important advantage for floating offshore wind. We have to think about that when you put the wind turbine on top of it. That would lead to a mass and force concentration in very, very high positions. But on the other hand, the small waterline area of a spar could also end up to a sensitivity to for example, changing the payload and so on. In an intact condition, the TLP concept may be the most stable floating offshore wind substructure type. It could also be the lightest concept, but within the domain of floating offshore wind, it cannot be self-afloat because of its negative GM without a tendon system. The cost of damage is therefore very high and could lead to an upside-down situation. For relatively shallow waters, the barge concept seems to be the only choice when a floating substructure has been decided to use instead of a fixed offshore installation. It has a large deck area, which is an advantage for maintenance and operation. New designs, including damping pool and so-called heave plates, have been introduced to improve the previous challenges on motion performance. To conclude, I don't think there are any single answer to the question, how does the turbine size impact the selection of a floating wind turbine substructure? I have tried to illustrate the complexity of designing an integrated system that, rather than sub-optimizing individual components like the turbine, the hull, or the mooring system. But rest assured, our tools Sesam and Bladed will help you to do the needed structural assessment for a floating offshore wind substructure and their moorings. And you can read more about that here in the link that you see behind me. Thank you very much for listening. Please reach out to us if you have further questions.